So we got a little audacious today. Mark and I, and I want to just give some kudos to my CEO, Mark Zangari, who I'll tell you that we took Neva's presentation this morning. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
and we built a model around it, and I'm going to do that approach where I show you the demo first. I'm not going to tell you what this is. And then I'm going to step back and say why this is important. And my goal today is that you leave feeling like you've seen the future. I'm trying to be futurist. I'm trying to show you what's coming down the pike over the next few years, coming out of Silicon Valley. How are we going to take all that great machine learning, AI, analytics that's, I guess, 90% of the use cases are in marketing and advertising right now, whether we're talking Facebook, Amazon, or Google. How are we going to start to push those use cases in ways that drive business value for telcos and for other verticals? So what I did, you can sort of think of this as a mind map of Mira's presentation. So she started talking about the net promoter score, which is something we're trying to achieve. And then she said, look, you know, what we discovered through our surveys and our research is that in order to achieve a net promoter score, we need to avoid this pain of having to deal with the call center. That's one of the ways you get to that. We need to reduce the people using the call center at all, right? So we're going to have some self-service that achieves that. Lack of consistent service, we want to improve kind of that unified customer view. And what we're looking at here is a structured, what we call a decision model of basically your job. That was my intent. And I didn't check with her beforehand. So I thank you for allowing me. On the left-hand side, in yellow, we have what are called decision levers. These are things that you can change. And as you change them, they ripple through your organization in order to ultimately produce the outcomes. In red, what we have, what we call externals, these are things that a service provider cannot change, but that they can measure. And as those external scenario variables change, your decision outcomes also change. So we're really in this very dynamic environment, which is kind of new for telecom, where as my competitors are doing new things, as my market is doing new things, I can't stick to the same decisions. I actually need to be constantly rebalancing those decisions and watching how they play out over time. So this is where Alice is, I mean, I thought I saw the future with your presentation, because to me this is this awesome, I mean, you were probably terabytes on the fly there.
In the background.
It's amazing. I mean, you guys, you don't know how long it takes to manipulate that much data. But where that stops is when you're done, you see the data. What you don't get is an answer to the question, if I make a decision, given all this data, how is that going to affect my business outcomes? So what I'm showing you here is how we go about taking these awesome data resources and maximizing their value in driving various business outcomes, whether it's revenues, as we talked about this morning, but ultimately it's net margins as well, because we need to get cost into this equation as well. And the theme here, and this will be throughout what I talk about, is we need a human in the loop, for one thing. And since a human's in the loop, it's just this is overwhelmingly complex. Let's just admit it. It is hard to wrap your brain against all that data and all those cells and all those spreadsheets. To get smart, we need to get into the visual part of our brain and actually into the motor part of our brain. And Alex, you may not know it, but when you touch the screen, you do that touch analytics, you actually get a little bit smarter. There's some interesting brain mechanics that happen when you start to put two hands on the screen, especially. And when you do touch, you actually get more intelligent. And so we need to take these new modalities seriously because the complexity problems we're facing are much greater. So we need to use touch, we need to use a visual interface, and we need to do something very interactive and dynamic. And so this is the dairy part of the presentation. We'll see if we pull this off. So that's what we did over lunch. Mark built this model in a dynamic interactive decision model. So it's not just a mind map, this is now a living model. And so what you saw in that same graph is a little hard to read the text here. But it's again those same levers, the things that I might be able to do, like improving the call center, smartphone self-service improvement was one of the levers we talked about, making the customer data consistent. So the idea is that you change these levers, and what you're trying to do is you're trying to have those affect these different intermediates, like how many people use the call center, which ultimately impacts your net promoter score. And then Neva also, you know, talked extensively about how net promoter the idea is you can start playing with these things, and you can say, as we make changes to our letters, let's observe how these impact the outcomes. And so what you can see is happening is I'm changing, you know, the investment I'm making in making my customer data consistent. And as I do that, it's having various impacts on my outcomes. In particular, I think you've wired up improved the call center marks. You can see as I'm improving the call center, it's having various impacts on my net promoter score and on my outcomes. So this is really what we need to do with all that data, right? Is we need to build these models of systems that answer this question. And here's the key question. There's one thing you remember today. It's take this question back to your organization. How do the decisions I made today impact the outcomes that I'm trying to achieve as a business? And how can I structure that thinking so that we can all collaboratively contribute to it, so that all the experts or surveys were part of what you did? I'm sure you said there's some great predictive analytics and big data stuff. That falls into the mix, but there's also a lot of human expertise in how you structure this. And how do you get all kind of those underutilized assets all to the table when you do it by having them in an interactive program? So that's kind of where I'm headed. So let me go back to the beginning of this and talk about moving from big data to big decisions. And I guess I shouldn't say from big data, it's like adding to big data. So this is like the next layer on top. Once you've got all this terrific data, how do you structure that in terms of a business problem that you want to solve? So we're kind of going from this question, again, that Alex has answered in a really world-class way. If I've got a lot of data, how can I use it? To this new question, which is, given this data, which represents my customers and my circumstances and my cause and effect and all those piece parts, which are really building blocks, how do I go from that data to answering the question, which is really the question people need to answer, is if I make this decision, if I move these levers, these things I have under my control, how does that ultimately impact my outcomes? And what's really neat is once you do that, you can then start to get some pretty sophisticated computer techniques like optimization going on, right? Once you've got the levers hooked up and systematically with the outcomes, you can start writing it backwards. And you can say, to achieve these outcomes, what are my optimal lever settings? Where is that sweet spot where I spend a minimal amount of money and maximize my net promoter score? And so now we get computers in the room to help us with that, which is amazing. Because in the past, you know, what do? You get the charts, get the graphs, and look at them, and you try to put those together in your head, and that's very, very difficult. Humans just aren't designed as creatures to hold all that information and to compile those numbers and graphs together. And so what we're talking about looking at the future is starting to use data as one ingredient in this better decision-making space. So, gosh, we've done so many surveys over the years. This is just a sample. This was a C-level service provider survey we did a couple years back. These guys say better use of our data and analytics can produce substantially more value than it does today. And we get a lot of strong agreement with this idea that there's this latent, untapped value. I believe that we're sitting on a treasure trove of data, but we need to evolve our approach in order to exploit it. Again, we have a lot of underutilized data resources. And just to kind of set the stage for the next 5 or 10 minutes, I think it's important that we sort of distinguish. There's really two ways we tend to use data. On the left-hand side, we have these fully automated solutions. So this is what's going on in Google and Amazon and in your fraud departments and in your churn analytics and in your call center. These are massive big data applications like churn and upsell and advertising and cross-sell. And fraud is a big one. These are applications that use big data, use predictive analytics and some pretty sophisticated algorithms. And these have been really, really matured over the last few years, and they do really well. But there's a whole new set of use cases where we have humans in the loop, right? Where we have the data that we're exploring in a self-service BI platform, or maybe we print it out, like these guys have these printouts and these graphs, and we're making these decisions that don't happen like every microsecond, as we have them advertised in Google, but they might happen about every month, right? And PwC has a survey that says, you know, on average, the typical executive makes about 3 of these big decisions per month. And don't take my word for it, but this is really an exploding concept. So here's PwC, who's talking about big decisions and how executives and data-driven times more likely to report significant improvement in their decisions. So this is, Alex, you're talking about a data-driven culture, and this is really kind of the box that I'm sitting in. So how do we take that concept of data-driven culture and add some structure to it? So PwC is talking about this. Carl Whitelock at Stratacast wrote a report that says it's critical to see over the horizon and around the corners to understand the impacts of today's decisions on all of the desired outcomes. This was really good. This is another PwC report, again, specifically about telecom capex. They say poor decision-making can cost, and in an industry that invests as much as telecoms, the total cost can be very large indeed. In fact, the ROI on capital, do you guys know this? It's about 6% on average, according to PwC's research. 3 percentage points less than the cost of capital itself. You'd do better putting that cash under the mattress than investing in telecom infrastructure. And if you go on to read this report, PwC really says it's the systematic, data-driven decision-making which is lacking and which is a tremendous opportunity to do better. And when you're looking at trillions of dollars predicted in just outside plant capex expenditures over the next few years, this represents, just this one use case, right, a huge opportunity to do better. And, you know, don't take my word for it, that's PwC. Harvard Business Review is sounding this drum, too. The rise of the decision factory. What do knowledge workers actually do? They don't manufacture products, but they do produce something. What do we do every day? We produce decisions. So let's get serious about this. And let's structure it. Let's make it evidence and database. AIG has a 140-person group that does evidence-based decision-making and provides that to the company at large. And they're trying to find the use cases within their organization that are amenable to using more evidence and more data and more structure. Rob Rich, TMF, getting back to the telecom, did a report on agile decision making. Same sort of story. So this is really, I just, you know, again, if I want to get one thing across, is there's an emerging discipline that's starting just like this week, basically, or some of these reports go back a year or so. But it's, we're starting to see this crystallize. We're starting to see kind of a critical mass of folks who know about this problem and are starting to converge on solutions to how we do better evidence-based decision-making. And, you know, one way to kind of make the contrast is that traditional analytics, we kind of start with the data, and we say, you know, we're not even going to talk about the business problem until the data's cleansed and migrated and all of that. And then once we've got all that work in, then we say, what decisions do we make? What business problems does this data solve? And this approach really turns that whole thing on its head. When I go in for consulting engagements, I get people mad because I say, leave your spreadsheet at home for the first day. I don't want to talk about the data because it ends up being very distracting. And again, cognitively speaking, it's overwhelming. Nobody wants to admit it, but it makes your head explode. So what we need to do is have a way we can collaboratively talk about business decisions. So first thing you do, take home lesson. What outcomes are we trying to reach? What's in agreement about that? You know, are we trying to get, you know, net EBITDA after 3 years or after 5 years? How long are we willing to go into the hole on our capex? You would not believe the number of organizations I go into where there's 10 guys in the room and each one of them is actually trying to achieve a different outcome. So they're unconsciously working against each other. They're pulling in opposite directions. So simply getting aligned, you get about, you know, fancy software, data, simply getting aligned around what we're all trying to achieve, you know, it's a consulting opportunity for those of you who provide that, is huge, and it's hugely underserved, and it sounds really obvious, but we're so bamboozled by the data that we actually lost track of our outcomes. And if by some miracle we're aligned about our outcomes today, a month from now, we will no longer be aligned around our outcomes because things will drift. So you have to reconnect and make sure everybody stays on the same page. Because you make 10,000 decisions at work every day, minimum. And if you're in sync with your coworkers, you're going to be pulling that company in the same direction, whether or not you have a fancy decision model. So that's just huge. And then data that supports that decision-making process, which also, by the way, means you're focused on much big data. People don't like to say this. You don't need big data. You start with headlines. And it turns out only five fields are the most critical of your decision-making process. So I'm contrarian, and people say that because we can't sell as many levers should we pull in which direction to get our outcomes? And we've gotten stuck there, right? We're doing this horrific data presentation. And then we look at these graphs. We think about this. We look at these graphs and this bar chart, and you upload them into your brain. And then you're making these very, very complex decisions in dynamic environments without any computer support.
Valley almost fits this. It's something that critical building.
lot of these complex systems models. Because often what we have is we have a bunch of data about the cause, like how much you invest in improving the call center, for instance. And then we have a bunch of data about the effect, which is maybe the results of a survey for customer net promoter scores. But we don't really know the relationship. Is it 3.2 times the age of the person plus 5 times their revenue last month plus 2 times their 1 if it's a woman and 0 if it's a man? There's this complex formula in there that's really invisible, and we don't know how to get it right. We don't know how to write a piece of software that takes us from cause to effect. So that's where machine learning fits in. So when we're talking about neural networks, supervised learning, backpropagation, decision trees, some fancy things like support vector machines, which is what Google and others are using, recommendation engines, that fits into each one of those links in that decision model. So now we've got some way of using this great new analytics technology that we've primarily used for a very limited set of use cases, and now building these models that allow us to apply this to a much broader set of use cases. And that's the challenge I'll leave you guys with, is think of those use cases. And my last 2 minutes. Oh, and then optimization, right? You push a button and the computer tells you what the decision is. So that's cool. So here's an example we did for outside plan build. We used this technique with a large cable operator, and by doing this approach, we were able to have 115 homes passed for every node in an HFC network compared to 72. And when we're looking at $1 trillion in outside plan spend over the next few years, that's a giant savings. And we got this by, again, structuring a business problem using data and then running optimization over it. So when you start to do this, we're not talking chicken feed. There's a huge value here. So here's another audacious thing I did. This is my visualization test platform. So we can do awesome visualizations, right? So this is a dynamic system with feedback loops. This is actually some carbon tax decisions that you might make around the economy. And what I'm showing is we can make ourselves look like a video game and really get all that touch, interactive, multi-touch screen stuff going, so that the younger generation really engages with these decision models as if they're really cool games, right? And then the goal is to figure out what are the decision lever settings, how much should I produce in order to achieve my goals and keep the carbon emissions low. And this is a telecom example. It's just really fun. I had so much fun with the particle generator on the spoke. It's so neat. And then here's the interest rate is my external factor that I can't change. That's how much it costs for me to finance my stuff. Anyway, I can take you guys through that if you want. I just think it's so cool. I'd love to show them. Tremendous.